I am told we also have people with us online, so we had to start on time. Camera is rolling, everything is beautiful. Thank you for attending this session. Good afternoon, everybody, dear film lovers, filmmakers, and colleagues. A warm welcome to you all to this session about green and sustainable film production. We have 60 minutes in front of us and a great lineup of speakers, ready to share the approaches and strategies for making film production greener. My name is Charlotte Appelgren, and I'm the General Secretary of CineRegio, the network of 50 film funds, public film funds in Europe. And yes, climate change is for real, and we all have a role to play to ensure the green transition in our sector. We can all make a difference individually and collectively, so everything is beautiful. Thank you so much for coming here. For the opening remarks, it's my great pleasure to welcome on stage Locarno Film Festival Deputy Marketing Director Fabienne Mallet. Fabienne, where are you? Here we go. The floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. So the topic of today's panel is really crucial to the Locarno Film Festival's organization, and we are truly delighted that Locarno can serve as a platform for a fruitful discussion around such an essential dimension. So to us, a sustainable approach has always been part of the festival values, and its strategic development is really integral on the strategy for the future mission, for the present and the future mission. Over the years, we have established several partnerships with primarily the aim at encouraging people, festival goers, on a slow mobility, on raising awareness on the importance in general of a conscious behavior, and above all, into taking into account the environmental aspect in the very design phase of each project we launch. And these efforts have allowed us to obtain a certification since 2010, which is a certification called Climate Neutral Event, which is issued by a Swiss non-profit organization called MyClimate. And this basically means that every emission that is caused by the festival and that cannot be avoided is offset by the funding of sustainable projects around the world. And moreover, this year we have published our first sustainability report following the guidelines dictated by the Global Reporting Initiative, the GRI. And we are among the first film festival to undergo this path. And the motivation behind it is actually quite simple, because being able to measure our impact by following standards and protocols that are internationally recognized allow us to create and pursue an even more transparent dialogue with all our stakeholders, and above all to really set sustainable development goals that can be measured and compared from edition to edition, but also we hope in the future from festival to festival. But it is not an easy task, because as you all may know, the reality of a film festival is quite complex. And to these days, there are still missing standards to measure the environmental impact of an organization like ours. But however, it's something we want to address. We want to address the sustainable development through the entire management cycle. And therefore, it's a long journey. We started years ago, it's a long way off, and we hope that moments of exchange like this one today can really help in bringing concrete improvements and insights for the future, not only of film festivals, but even more importantly of the film industry as a whole. So I really wish you a very pleasant and fruitful panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fabien, and also for introducing us to the Locarno Film Festival's green actions and sustainability plans. And I have to say, I read the sustainability report on the website, and it's very impressive. So if you have not already had a look at it, please go and have a read of it. It's fantastic news. Now, I didn't plan for this rain coming down, pouring us up now, but it's for sure it's a reminder that the climate change is for real. So without further ado, let's turn our focus to our five panelists. We will start out with listening to two public institutions presenting their concrete strategies and plans for the future and tools, and how they contribute to the green transition. And then we will move to the film community point of view and hear the experiences from a film director, an eco manager, and last but not least, a producer. The producer role is very important as we embark this green transition. So let's start with the good news from the National Film and Audiovisual Center in France, the CNC. The CNC recently announced a 3-year strategy for the green production in Europe. Not in Europe. It would wish for that it was in Europe, but let's start with France. To explain this to us, I'm proud to give the floor to the Director of European and International Affairs at the CNC. Mathieu, the floor is yours.
Thank you. How does it work? Is it working?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. Buonasera a tutti. Thank you for having me and having us here. First, I'm going to be extremely concrete. I think at CNC we've been tackling this issue for quite a long time, and we've just changed buildings recently, and we have completely changed the way we are working as a public institution. So I think that before putting new rules or discussing with film professionals about what should be done, we have done our homework, if I may say, and we've started to reshape and change completely we are working. It started with no more plastic bottles, no more printing papers, only recycled papers, shared offices, new mobility policies. You don't have people from CNC flying to Cannes Film Festival anymore. Everybody takes the train from Paris. It's a bit longer, but it's much better for everyone. And it's something I think that it's helping a lot, because on a daily basis, we've changed our habits and we've changed the way we do things. We organize meetings, the way we use the printers. We have one printer per floor. So, of course, you have to walk a few meters to go to the printing machine, so you don't use it anymore. And this has been a good way to include all the staff in these new policies. The Cannes Film Festival, we were listening to Locarno Film Festival. The Cannes Film Festival has changed a lot as well. I don't know if you were in Cannes, but you might have seen that it was only electrical cars and hybrid cars that are used by the festival. And we've put in place a carbon compensation fund for all international guests at the festival. Regarding the CNC, as you may know, CNC is the public institution and the Film National Fund in France, but it is also a general direction of the Ministry of Culture. So we set the rules, we set the regulations. And we have recently announced in Cannes, so like 3 weeks ago, a three-year plan that will start next year, 2022, and will go until 2024. To put in place new regulations in France regarding sustainability. The thing is that we are estimating at least 2 million CO2 tons what the industry is like producing each year. If you include the fabrication, the industry like that is doing things like smartphones or film cameras and things like that, we are at 10 million a year, which is absolutely huge. So we have decided to not to take our time, but to do things step by step. So we have appointed a group of four independent experts on four different topics. The first one is the technical facilities. The second one is what we call sobriété numérique, digital I don't know how to say sobriété, like sobriety, digital sobriety. Mobility, supplies and waste. And each of these experts have started to give us some advice and some regulations. Starting next year, we are going to put in place an observatory of the sustainability in France, and we're going to work on a joint method how to calculate and how to measure the impact of the industry on the environment. Starting 2023, we will calculate the impact of each film, because in France we are very focused on what we call l'œuvre, so the film, the television content program. So we will calculate jointly with the industry and the stakeholders and the professional, we will all agree on something that is acceptable by everyone, on how to calculate the impact of each film on the environment. And starting 2024, we will have rules and regulations, which means that to benefit from the schemes and from the funding of the CNC, the National Film Board, you will need to be sustainable. Otherwise, you won't be eligible. This is what we've done recently with another important topic, which is sexual harassment. And to be able to benefit from the schemes and the funding of the French National Film Board, film production companies, film professionals, film festivals, have to have followed a specific dedicated training and have to have put in place specific measures to fight sexual harassment. This is the same spirit that we want to imply for the sustainability and fight for climate change, and it's pouring rain, so I think we are exactly in the center of the topic. But even if it's very often raining in Locarno, but still. So basically, this is what we're doing. We're just starting. We just announced it in Cannes this year, so we're going to start working with film professionals, and we have a producer with us here that will speak a little bit later. And it's very important for us that this plan is put in place all together. It's not just the government saying, oh, this is what you have to do. No, this is how we are going to do it, all of us together. And hopefully that will be a path for other European film agencies, and we are always eager to work with our European partners. And we have our General Secretary of IFA, the European Film Agency, in the room, and I'm sure this is a topic we will tackle all together with our 35 or 38 members, I can't remember, because this is not country by country that we will fight this, but it's all of us together if we want to make a change.
Thank you very much, and yeah, big applause here. And for explaining us the strategy of the CNC, but also this about, I think it's very important that you are going to work with the industry. So it's not something just you applying to the industry, but you're actually going to work with the industry to get the best results. And I think this is a very important point to take with us. And the other point I was taking with me was this about that from the 1st of January 2024, to get money from the CNC, you have to have a green strategy or apply some kind of green protocol. That is very exciting too. I will keep you up on that one.
That might be in March. I'm not sure about the date, but that's
2024. But I will call you in January, anyhow. And also thank you also for bringing this out about the collective, that it's an effort we can do together all over Europe. I mean, some territories are more advanced than other territories, but it's all about sharing the knowledge. And this is also why this panel is so important. And we could have tons of examples with us today, but these are the examples chosen by the Locarno poll, and I'm very happy for these panelists. So thank you for that. And I think we will just move on because we only have 60 minutes. So let's move from France to Italy and to the Trentino region. Our next panelist will explain to us the rating and certification system, for green film production, which have existed now for some years in Italy. And to explain this to us, I'm delighted to present to you the film commissioner of the Trentino Film Fund and Commission. Alberto, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Charlotte. Good evening, everyone. My name is Alberto Battocchi, and I'm a film commissioner at Trentino Film Commission, and Film Fund and Commission. And I'm here to tell you a story, and as every nice story, it starts with a problem. And our problem locally was that as Film Commission, we host on our territory, as all the film commissions do, film production coming from other regions in Italy and from other European countries. And we saw that although we are in a region, our region is very sensitive to environmental issues and sustainability in many other sectors. We, as the local reference point for the audiovisual sector, we were not doing anything. I'm talking about five, six years ago. We were not doing anything concrete to reduce the impact of film productions in our territory. So while we were very happy to host productions, we felt the need to do something because we were well aware about the fact that film production have an impact, and you all know that they have an impact on our environment. And so we didn't have any experience ourselves in the field of sustainability or in the environment. So we started working together with our local environmental protection agency. We worked together at the development of an instrument which is called Green Film Rating System, and a certification attached to that, to propose to producers on a voluntary basis, producers who came to our region to shoot, in order to motivate them and try to move them towards the reduction of the impact on the environment of their work. What we did, well, our system is based on a number of very concrete and easy to implement actions, very simple, that producers can put into practice while they are shooting their projects. These actions are subdivided into six main areas, and these areas are very, very common. Some of them are the same that Mathieu mentioned during his intervention. So it's we are talking about energy saving, transportation and accommodation, waste management, catering and drinks and beverages on set. The waste management probably is already said. And the use of the power of communication that our industry has to convince other people towards sustainability. I mean, if I myself, who am nobody, I say you should be sustainable, you should reduce your impact. No, maybe nobody cares, but if a director, a producer, an actor come up on a stage and say, okay, we did a sustainable film, I think that's the impact of their communication is much different. So this is something we believe in. And going back to the actions that are included in our rating system, to each one of these actions, a mark, like a score, is attached. If a producer engages and complies with all the actions included in the rating system, the maximum points they get is 50 points. But in order to be inclusive, we don't require for getting the certification, and I will get to the certification in a minute. Producer do not need to gain 50 points, but just 20 points out of 50. And this idea is meant for allowing producers to choose which actions they can put into practice. Because we are well aware that every project is different, and so while on film A, the producer can engage in doing a number of actions, in film B, the actions that can be implemented are can be different. So we wanted, especially at the beginning, to keep our threshold low. And basically what happened is that we proposed this to the producers, and it was a very good success. From the beginning, about 50% of the producers who were shooting back then, it was 2017 in our region, from the very beginning, 50% of the producers decided to adopt this measure. And we were really surprised and happy. Do I have a couple of minutes more? Yeah. About certification, it's very easy. When a producer on a voluntary basis chooses to follow our protocol, and they apply for certification before the shooting, they, together with a green manager, they prepare a sustainability plan declaring which action they are willing to perform during the shooting. And then during the shooting and after the shooting, an independent third party verifying body verifies that the producers actually did what he promised. And then if the verifying body issues a report, if the report is positive, we issue the certification. And last thing I would like to say is that verifying bodies can be public or private entities. In our land, in our territory, the Environmental Protection Agency is the verification verifying body, and so it's his services for free. Where in territories where public verifying bodies are not active, we decided to involve a couple of companies at the moment, and they will grow the number of these companies. It's auditing companies with international that operate internationally. Two of them are very big. One is Bureau Veritas, based in France, with more than 500 offices around Europe. And the second one is the NVGL, based in Norway, and more or less they have the same number of offices in every European countries. And they are enabled and they are accredited as verifying bodies. This means that following green film, producers can certify their projects all over Europe. And what's very relevant to us, also in the case of co-productions, meaning that if a producer is shooting a film half in Italy and half in France, they will find verifying bodies and support for certification in both countries, so they can use the same instrument all over Europe. And for us, this is what is more important, because we started locally, but then we understood that thinking locally is good for the beginning, but then we have to grow and work together at a European level.
Thank you very much, Alberto. And just to follow up on what you said, I mean, so it's max 50 points you can get. You need to get 20 points to get the certification, but of course you can be more ambitious than that. So that's what each territory can set, whatever standard they want to. But if we want to use it for co-production, it's 20 points. And this is what is unique about the system, that we actually have a system here which can be used cross-border.
Yeah, and it's active, it's like working now, so it's...
And you are happy to explain it to whoever would like to hear about it. And I'm also happy to say that we have another panelist who can also, they also have offering a system on certification. So we will also hear from that point of view, that can also be worked for co-productions. And the last thing I just want to point out is that it's actually been adopted by other public film agencies, the Green Film Rating System. So in the French-speaking part of Belgium, Wallonia, the film fund Wolimash, and also Catalonia in Spain is now going to implement it in November, I think it is.
Yes.
So different territories are applying it now. So let's see how it will go.
Yeah, and Wallonia, they are even working, they are even tougher than we are, because in our region, and incentives that we attach to the certification, because what I forgot to say is that in our region, if since we are both a film fund and a commission, if a film applies to our film fund and they get the certification, they get extra points, meaning extra money. Yeah. And in our region, that is voluntary. In Wallonia, it's compulsory.
Exactly. But I also think the good news is that for those of you who are representing funds or territories who wants to make the green transition, the experience from Trentino is that even if you do not get the bonus, the film producer still wants to use the green certification system. So this is very positive news, and I think this just explains that the film industry as such want to go green. They just need the tools and they just need the incentives to go there. So now let's move to the Trentino region, the region of the Locarno Film Festival, and to hear from the point of view of, yes, sorry to say, a brilliant film director. You also have a film here at the festival. So, Nicolo, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Brilliant, I'm not sure. Brilliant. I'm here as director and as director of Ticino Film Commission, and I'm bringing you my point of view. I'm bringing you, I think, more my question and my doubts, not solution. My last movie, Atlas, is shown here in Locarno Film Festival, was done in Trentino, also with Alberto, in co-production with Tempesta Film, so with Eco Movie Rules, with Ludovica. So I don't want to repeat something productional, something that it's already said or it will be said by Ludovica. I want to give you maybe a point of view of the artistic point of director and their director's team, so assistant director, because What I experienced in the past is also what I feel is that we have a double responsibility in this issue. We have to do more sustainable film, so we have to participate as director in the artistic way to make more sustainable film, but we are part of on a cultural part of the formation of the awareness in the audience. It's like the gender topic, the Me Too topic. We are not a Swiss bank that only decides to throw away the plastic cups and to go green, but we are also creating awareness in the society. So how can we make these, and how aware have we to make some compromises as director to make film in the future? I remember when I did my first feature as assistant director in 2008, it wasn't a topic. I was already some green, and I was bringing these small pocket ashtrays to all the crew, to all the people that was smoking on the crew, and everybody is smoking in a film set, only to don't have the cigarette butts on the floor during the shooting. And I was all the people on the set was liking watching me like a crazy man bringing the ashtrays. 10 years later, we did the Atlas. We give this bottle to everybody on the set, and we passed from hundreds of plastic bag caps a day to zero because of bottle, and everybody was happy because they can have some warm coffee also on the set on the night. And not and something fresh during the day when we shoot on the sun. And I saw in these 10 years a changement of the awareness on the set. But my question was, what can I do for the awareness outside, and what can I do really in an artistic point of view? For example, now I'm preparing a documentary, and I start to ask myself, should I travel 12 hours in a flight to do an interview in the Borneo for my documentary, or should I do the interview through Skype? Is an opportunity that I have today, and I don't want to give you answer because I don't know, because every project is different, but it's a question that we have to do to ourselves when we start to shoot a movie today, because I have to ask myself, it worth to spend 2 kilos of CO2 for every person of the crew to move on the Borneo to do a 2 hours interview or not? This is an important question we have to do now. It's our responsibility. On the same field, it's for example, if I found a perfect field to shoot, a perfect location to shoot my sequence on the move of the movie 3 hours away by car, should I move all the crew over there because this location is perfect? Or should I stay close to where I am? And the location is not perfect 100%, but I can spare some CO2. This is a question that I think we have the responsibility to do, to have and to speak about with the producer, with all the people involved in the crew on a production. And I think we have also to be part of this topic. Sometimes my feeling is, there is some rules imposed from the top, from the film commission, from the financer, from the institution. But if we don't have these changes also in the mindset of the crew, we cannot reach a really important goal. We cannot reach a real change on the set, and then we cannot reach changes also in the audience of our movies. And there is also some other question I do myself. Should we in the future put a panel on the opening credits of the movie, like now we have these no animals we mistreat on the movie? Should we put a panel? This is a sustainable film. Should we or not? Should I do this to only to wash my how can I say? Yeah, exactly. Or should I do something behind the curtains just because I want to do something more sustainable? I think this is a crucial question. We have to do this question, and we have to be together, production, financer, and also festival. Sometimes I ask me, should Locarno have a green filmmaking award next year? Maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe it's a very good idea to bring this awareness to the audience. Maybe it's something not only just for the image, but not only that we feel deep inside ourselves. And I think this is an important topic, and we as director, we have to sensibilize the crew and the audience through also our movies. In Atlas, just to be quick, in Atlas, for example, the protagonist of my movie, she moves on bicycle and train, not because I want to change the mind of the audience and I want to promote bicycle and train, but because I move with bicycle and train. I rarely use my auto, my car. And I think also this topic are important for the screenwriting. So the process have to start very early and to finish at the festival, to finish on the distribution of movie. And I think we all on this panel, but we all have to be a part of a discussion that starts maybe in these years, but have to be cared about everybody in the future. And I feel I'm really happy to be in an area where we can create something in this direction.
Thank you very much, Nicolo. Big applause. It's always very important to have the point of view of the filmmakers, and so thank you very much for your insight and also for bringing this topic up on greenwash, which we of course have to remember in our journey during the green transition. Also very interesting this about the mindset change of the crews and others, and also I'm very happy to hear that more and more film directors now are also getting involved in the topic, because I have to say we have been missing a little the point of view of the film director. So thank you for leading the way.
I'm not leading the way, I'm just part of the thing, and I have also to change myself, because of sure as director I want to be totally free, and I would like to do everything in my movie, but I have to do compromises because of financial, because of a lot of topics, and I think I should bring also this topic in the compromise I have to do, not only to be sustainable, but also to change the way we do movies in the future, and to be honest also with myself, how will I do a movie in the future.
Thank you very much. And also just bringing this, the other topic you were mentioning, this about the planning, so starting at the very early stage, which is also, I think it's a very valuable point for us to take further with us. You have an extra comment, it seems, for that.
I'm very curious what Ludovic and the other says. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So, anyhow, no matter what we say, still the majority of film production is making a mess. We cannot ignore that. So, to help the green transition, we also have a private company with us today. We have EcoMovie, which will tell us a little, and Ludovica, you're also an eco manager, which is also a very important role in this whole green transition of our sector. We need more eco managers. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for, fighting this weather to be here. Yes, as everyone else mentioned, we also work in films. We work in the all audiovisual sector. EcoMovie was born by producers, so it works with and for producers. I think this is the main key point that needs to come out, and the first one that I wanted to make. How this happens is that EcoMovie travels with the production. So no matter where you're going, if you're moving to different regions, it's an international tool and service. And this is, how does this happen? This happens because we study tailor-made solutions for each production. So our EcoMovie is not just a protocol, it's not just a document, although it's arguably, for me I'm biased, but it's a valid one. It's mainly and first of all a service that it's integrated in all phases of production with all departments. So as Nicola was mentioning, it's all about including everyone in the process. It cannot be just a sort of top-down approach where the producer or the fund or anyone gives us this Bible to follow, but it's about how do we program each element. So it's about buying fabrics, by building by all of the things that we do already, and how do we plan those in advance? And this also, we evaluate the whole life cycle. So we go from pre-production, which is also crucial, as we were mentioning, it needs to be very early on, to shooting, but also to post-production. So we're starting to ask questions about how you are, for example, making sure that your post production laboratories are energy efficient, how you're handling your waste in labs, and so on. And so basically, this it's what we usually we call it an integrated service, because we go and touch upon the lives, let's say, of each crew member and also cast. We have a green rider, so we ask all of our cast to also adhere to our measures. And usually, you know, maybe when you try to convince an actor that we would like them to, I don't know, car share with someone, it sounds maybe a bit they sound maybe skeptical. When you tell them we're doing this for the environment, of course they are the first to agree and to be actually proud to make this change. Ecomovie was born in 2013, so we've been going for a while. I came in later on, but we also updated quite recently in last May. We did an update both because we expanded our reach to the whole audiovisual sector, so to documentaries and short films, of course with due differences, because of course it's different to shoot a smaller documentary, but also to be up to date to the most like ambitious EU standards. Of course, it's easy, like a lot of us were mentioning, we are at the beginning. I'm air quoting because our industry is not really at the beginning. We've been talking about this for 10 years, but we also believe that with the support that we provide, it's important to go all in and to be very ambitious with what we do and to touch upon everyone's job. So what we do is basically a very hands-on approach. We're on set, we're talking to crew, we're talking to everyone, and it's quite radical, meaning that we're going from the big elements such as energy consumption, waste management, and everything that was mentioned, to the very fine details. So how are you dyeing your fabrics with natural dyes? Are you purchasing fair trade materials versus bio materials, and so on? So we try to really go in depth, and all of this at the end comes similarly to what we were saying, also to a certification. So what we do is that we hand a lot of data to a third party that's an accredited certification agency. So it's a certification, meaning that basically it has legal value everywhere in Europe. And we give it all of our information so that they can, starting from our integrated planning, go to a lot of data. When we talk about data, I think it's very important to give just a small parenthesis without falling into this discussion we had a debate earlier about CO2. We do not only evaluate CO2 emissions. As you can imagine, not all environmental impact is CO2, right? Not everything can be quantified. So we provide CO2 emissions alongside other impact measures. And so at the end, all of this work with seems a lot, but believe me, it's not if you take it from the beginning. We have impact data, we have concrete results, and of course we have a culture shift, because as we were saying, it's really important, and we see that happening. I work sometimes with crew that have worked with me before, and you can see them and tell me, you know, we have adopted some of the measures even when you were not there, even if this was not an Ecomovie certified product. And so basically these two elements, the sort of grassroots element of the integrated service and the higher up protocol, kind of come together for this solution. We of course we started with the protocol when almost none were available. Now more and more are happening. I once heard a colleague say that if we printed all of the protocols that already exist, we would probably have a pile as high as me, maybe. I'm very short, but anyways. And so I think it's what's important is to really come to the real life of set and to be from crew. And I think that's also what's really crucial from coming from producers and coming from a producing background, because you really are in the life with the people. And we don't have much time. I agree that we need to be entry level. I don't agree that we need to be entry level, actually. Every step, I'll say this much better, every step in the right direction, some people say it's a good step. I agree to a degree. I think we also need to be very ambitious and to strive change. We have an industry that is very glamorous, that can, you know, with one movement, shape the whole industry and everything, so good to go, but also I think it's time to really accelerate what we're doing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ludovica. If I just may add and ask you, the Eco Manager, how did you become an Eco Manager? We have some people here in the audience who want to go this way, because as I said, we need the training, we need Eco Managers or Eco Consultants, as they are called in other some territories. What do we need to do?
Yes, that's a million-dollar question. Everyone asks me that. So what I believe, so of course what we need with a green manager, eco-manager, so on, is to have the two dimensions. So being well-versed in sustainability, in the technology that's around it, and all the different elements of handling sustainable management systems. And on the other hand, we need concrete production experience. Often I find, maybe I'm wrong, and we can discuss about this, I think that usually, since our job is very peculiar, it's really risky to bring people that are into sustainable management of other fields and just put them on set, because they will likely maybe not understand our timings or our roles or the weird ways that we do stuff sometimes. So I think it's really important to have that background in the beginning, and then of course to be just learning about everything that is about management systems, and also from other fields. A lot of technology is being developed, such as, I don't know, electric generators and so on, and of course then we need to shift them to our needs. But yeah, those two elements I think is really crucial.
Thank you very much. So our last panelist is a producer, which is absolutely fantastic that Julia, you wanted to join us here today. Julia have last year co-founded her own production company, but before that worked on a number of films, been selected for various festivals and so on, and had been working on the topic of green and green film production for a long time now. A lot of pioneering work you have been doing. So please, Julia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm going to try to put my voice higher than the storm. I'm not going to repeat everything that has been said, because it's already a lot, but it's true that when I started production, I already wanted, without having any incentive or obligations from public funding, we really wanted at OECOUR to find ways to produce in a way more sustainable way. So we tried on every film. Not every film is sustainable, and we also have to take off this guilt. You know, the producer has already a lot on our shoulder. We have a lot of responsibility, and I think it has to be a positive and a joyful way of thinking about green, not about greenwashing. I'm totally pro stating in the credits of your film that you had a sustainable way of making your film, because I think it's also marketing is very important in terms of image. And so 5 years ago, I first tried something on The Night Eats the World, which was a zombie film that was in Rotterdam. And as you know, for zombie films, there are a lot of makeup, lots of waste. But we were really trying to do some stuff. And I tried to calculate the carbon with the EcoProd system that was in place at that moment. It has changed a lot since then, but at that moment, it was what we call in French a machine à gaz, so basically a factory of gas, a nuclear factory. It was really, really, I spent like one day trying to understand it, and I never dig into it ever again. I put it in front of the line producer, and I told the line producer, please, Gaetan, do it, I can't do it. She was like, I can't do it either. I mean, it's so complicated. So this carbon calculator has also to be way more friendly and vulgarized and democratized, so that we producer, the line producers, the production manager can take over and use it. And for me, these carbon calculators are a very good thing to get numbers. This is exactly what we did with the Collective 50-50, because I'm also the co-head of the Collective 50-50, which is the gender and inclusion association in France for parity. And this is how we worked with CNC. We first work on numbers, gathering the numbers. And when we had numbers, we can say, okay, those numbers are too low, those numbers are too high. How do we do? What is the trajectory to have a higher number? And so after that, I tried again on several films. And on Gagarin, I think I can give a little bit of concrete elements, even though you gave most of them. But first of all, you have to think about this in pre-preparation. You don't think about green when you start shooting. It's over. You have to think about it at the very end of development when you start financing your film and when you start thinking about the shooting plan. Not obviously to change things in the script. Our directors never change anything in the script for green purpose, but they change it for time and money purpose, which sometimes goes with green purpose at the same on the same level. For instance, I think at one point there was a scene in Guyane, so very far away, and we say no, we're not going to Guyane. It's a small film. Gagarin was like a 2.3 million euro budget. Was in Cannes last year. It was released by Film Copine in Switzerland this year. And the particularity of this project was that we would shoot 4 weeks, 5 weeks, in the same place, which was an old project about to be demolished. So we had kind of a studio, and that allowed us to think about a green strategy that was really radical in a way. So we were recycling from the coffee powder to all the production set and the production design. Everything was recycled. We bought, like Marion Burger, our production designer, she bought all the production sets and equipment already from used stuff, from Le Bon Coin, from eBay, from whatever. And then we recycled it after the shoot. So it's a constant recycling cycle. We implemented in the contract also for our crew and cast a little notice and acknowledgement that the film will be sustainable, eco-responsible, and that the cast and crew will have to follow the rules that we will state. So this is also a contractual thing to mention because it's an acknowledgement, you know, it's just like harassment. When you state in the contract that no harassment is allowed on the set and that this is the rule, the legal rule, then people read it and know it, and it's acknowledged. Even though I don't think we can fire someone, I would need a legal advisor, but I don't think we can fire someone if they don't respect a green rule, but still, it's acknowledged in the contract. Other staff, so to work on all of this, I wanted to work with an agency because I'm not an expert in green. I mean, I'm recycling my plastic at home, but I'm not an expert. So I contacted Sequoia, which is kind of the same agency as you. It's the same agency as EcoProd. And I asked them, I was like, I'm sorry, I don't have 40K. Because usually this, it's we'll talk about cost, I think, later, but it's a cost to engage an eco-manager, to engage into this prep, into this thinking. And I didn't have 40,000 euros to spend. And this is usually what it costs when you really want to calculate your carbon. You have to have someone, an eco-manager, on set every day, following the prep, following the shoot, sometimes following the post-production as well. We didn't have that money. It was a small budget film. So Sequoia basically tailored an advisement, basically they supervised everything. They read the shooting plan, they read the script, they saw where the locations were, they discussed a lot with our line producer and our production manager, and they gave us tailored guidelines for the film. So we had some signalytics, you know, like some things that we would put on all of our the service, I forgot the name in English. I mean, on all of our daily shooting page, they would, they would put us in relation with the right people to recycle everything, you know, and we would stock everything in a place. So we need a stocking place. You know, everything has to be found, but everything takes more time. That's why you can't think about green shooting 2 weeks before shooting. It has to be planned 2 months before. And what they did as well, so basically we paid, I think, a total like 2,000 or 5,000 euro fee, something pretty small that everyone can afford. And they tailored something that was really that was strong and kind of radical as well, even though I'm sure we were not 100% sustainable, but we were super proud also for the crew. We had a vegetarian canteen, so not all of the crew is vegetarian, obviously, and if it had been a problem, I mean, I don't know anyone who's only carnivore, so, but if we had like one technician or one cast member that would eat only meat, we would have made a special meal for this person, but it didn't happen. So we had vegetarian food, we had a local canteen because we worked really closely with the inhabitants of the project where we were shooting. So basically we talked with an association of women that I knew from the prep who really helped us a lot doing the film. And I asked them, I was like, do you want to be our canteen? And they were like, we've never done that. I was like, well, try. And so it was a bit of pedagogy from our line producer to organize everything with them. But we had the best canteen. They would go to the market every day. All the meals were really family meals. You know, it was, even for the crew, it brought something on set, a kind of harmony also, that was really, they were giving us food, you know, just like on a school canteen, and they were putting all their love, and basically we paid them, and we paid them the normal amount of a canteen. But as we had only vegetarian meals, we succeeded in decreasing the budget of food of like 10,000 euros. This is the cost of meat on a set. So, and some of them with this money, they created this association. One of them got back to school to study medicine. I mean, there is this sentence from the guy, Charles at Sequoia, that I love. He says, ecology without CSR is gardening. So you have to have a social impact. You have to think about ecology with a social impact. Both go together. And I love thinking about the fact that what the Sense is currently doing with this green bonus that might happen one day, hopefully not malus, but bonus, is exactly what we did with you when we tailored the parity bonus, the gender balance bonus in France. Basically today, every production that have on a scale of 9 key crew members, 5 women, is allowed to have a 15% incentive on the automatic support. So it's when you started the implementation of it, there were 12% of films that were eligible for it. And 2 years later, there are 32% of films that are eligible to this bonus. So it's a huge step. And producers that were a bit like, oh, la la, I'm not going to force my director to work with a female DOP. There is no female DOP. Well, there is. And actually, they found it because they saw that it was a great incentive. And I think that I implemented, and we are a bunch of producers who tried. I'm going to scream now about...
It's getting louder and louder. You have to speak louder.
Please, please.
But anyhow, Julie, thank you so much for this insight into the producer's point of view. I think it was fantastic. Big applause. And also, Julie, I mean, congratulations on that you're actually also making policy suggestions. I think that's also nice. I'm sure you would be able to communicate. Climate change, I don't know. Is this normal in Locarno?
It's the Indian mountain.
No? Okay. What can we do? So let's see here. We just have another few minutes. I just want to get back to this about the cost. Because what I hear a lot of times from producers is, okay, but the green transition is not for free. The green transition costs us money. Who will pay for the eco-producer? Who will pay for the electrical car instead of the diesel cars? What about the generators, etc.? So what are the producers saying to that?
No, this is what I wanted to say. Is that just that we can try individual things, you know, and Gagarin was a prototype and we tailored something because I was caring about it, the directors were caring about it, and everyone remembered this film as a green shoot. But we can't do that without the support of regional funding, of public funding, because at one point the cost is still a big cost, and we can't assume it alone as producers. So even with the best intentions, we need this public support.
Sorry, Julius, not to stop you, but I think it seems that nobody can hear anything. Is that correct?
Yes, wow.
I think that, I think that due to the rain and the climate change and everything, I don't think we will have the possibility of actually continuing for so much longer. Also, I hear thunderstorms now. Anyhow, what we know and we have learned from this panel is that making green film production is possible. There are certification systems, schemes out there, all ready to use. We know that the French National Film and Audiovisual Fund is ready to go. 3 years from now, we'll have the great plan. And last but not least, we should not put a financial burden on the independent films and on the independent producers. We have to find the money somewhere else to do that. And just to remember, all of you, you don't have to be a superhero to be sustainable. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the great speakers, to Locarno Pro for organizing this panel, and of course to the technical crew. Thank you very much.